Welcome to another lecture in Vector and Tensor Analysis. This is our second lecture of Vector and Tensor Analysis. In the previous lecture, we discussed the geometrical representation of vectors. And we defined the basic algebraic operations on vectors using their geometrical representation. And in today's lecture, we are going to interpret vectors analytically. So we are going to discuss analytical representation of a vector, and we will define the same algebraic operations on vectors using their analytical representation. Okay, but before we start with the analytical representation of a vector, so let us talk about the rectangular coordinate system in space. So, rectangular coordinate system in space or three-dimensional space. Okay, so our three-dimensional rectangular system consists of three mutually perpendicular lines meeting at a point called the origin, and the lines are OX, OY and OZ. So here these lines are called axes. Okay, so OX, so this is our X axis, this is Y axis and this is Z axis. Okay, so our rectangular coordinate system consists of three mutually perpendicular lines called axes, and these lines divide our space into three coordinate planes. Okay, so it makes three planes. So this plane is xy plane, so this is xy plane, and this is yz plane, and this is xz plane. Okay, so in our three-dimensional rectangular coordinate system, we get three mutually perpendicular planes as well. Okay, so now any point being represented in this space will have three coordinates x, y and z. So it will have three components, one along the x-axis, one along the y-axis and one along the z-axis. Okay, so here in order to draw this point, we take x in x-axis. Suppose this is x, and this is y along y-axis, and this is z-coordinate along z-axis. Okay. So, as we are talking about vectors, so let us define three basic or unit vectors inside this three-dimensional space. So, unit vectors. So again, let us consider our three-dimensional rectangular coordinate system. Okay, let us consider three points. One is on the x-axis with coordinates 1, 0, 0. And the another point B is on the y-axis with coordinates 0, 1, 0. And another is point C on the z-axis with coordinates 0, 0, 1. Okay. So, with these points, we define the vectors, this vector OA, vector OB and vector OC. Okay. So, here, these vectors. So vector OA we call this vector the vector I, unit vector I along the x-axis, and the vector OB is written as unit vector J along the y-axis, and the vector OC is the unit vector along z-axis, and this is unit vector K. So we use this hat symbol to show that it is a unit vector. Okay, now we discuss the components of a vector. So component of a vector. So if we have our rectangular coordinate system, and suppose we have two points, a point P with coordinates x1, y1 and z1, and another point, suppose Q, with coordinates x2, y2 and z2, okay, then a vector from P to Q, let us call this vector A as vector A, okay, then this vector A will have components along all of these axes, along x-axis, y-axis and z-axis, okay. Then the component of this vector A along x-axis will be then x2 minus x1. So this will be the component of the vector A along x-axis. So let us call this component as A1. So A1. So this is component along x-axis. Similarly, the components along y-axis of this vector will be y2 minus y1. We call it A2. So this is a component along y-axis, y-direction. Similarly, z2 minus z1, let us call this number. So these are scalars basically. So let us call this number as A3. So this is component along z-direction or z-axis. Okay, so these are scalars, these are components. Then the vectors A1i, A2j and A3k. So these are component vectors of A. Okay, so now these are component vectors. So these are component vectors of A. So A1i is the component vector of the vector A along x-axis. A2j is the component vector of vector A along y-axis. And A3k is the component vector of this vector A along the z-axis or z-direction. Okay. Now we can introduce the analytical form of a vector inside this three-dimensional space. Okay, so let us consider again the rectangular coordinate system. So let us consider a point P inside this space with coordinates A1, A2, A3, okay? So it means, so suppose this is, this distance is A1 and this distance is A2. And then this distance is A3. So let us call these points as, so this is our point, suppose A, this is B. Now, if we consider this vector vector OP. Let us call this vector A. Okay, then the components of the vector A along the component of vector A along x-axis will be a1i. So it means this vector, if we call it a vector, vector OA, so this vector will be a1i. Similarly, this vector AB is the component of this vector OA along y-axis. This is A to J. And similarly, B to P vector. So this is the component vector of this vector A along the z-axis. So it will be A3K. Okay. So now from this figure over here, we can use the head to tail rule or the polygon law of addition of vectors. So by using polygon law of addition of vectors, so we can say that OP vector is equal to OA vector plus AB vector plus BP vector. Okay. So OP vector is vector A is equal to OA vector. OA vector is A1i. How about AB vector? So AB vector is A2j and BP vector is A3k. Okay. So this representation of the vector A, this representation is called analytical representation. Okay. So analytical representation expresses a vector in terms of its components along different axes. Okay. So in three-dimensional space, a vector is expressed analytically by its components along x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. So this is the analytical representation of this vector. Okay, so if we talk about the magnitude of this vector A, there is the length O to P, then what will be this length? So here we can see that this is a right angle. So this is a right triangle. Similarly, this is also a right angle. So two right triangles are also formed over here. So in order to find the length of this vector A, to find OP length, we consider this right angle triangle OBP. Okay. So from this right angle triangle OBP, using Pythagorean theorem, we can write OP square is equal to OB square plus BP square. Okay, so OP square is simply the length of the vector A square. Now what is OB square? From this triangle, right angle triangle, OB square is equal to OA square plus AB square. So OB can be further written as OA square plus AB square. So plus BP square as it is. So the magnitude of the vector A square will equal to OA square. What is OA? So OA is, what is this length? This length is, length OA is A1. So A1 square. AB is A2. This length is A2 squared. Similarly, BP is A3 squared. So this means the magnitude of vector A will be equal to A1 squared plus A2 squared plus A3 squared whole squared. Okay, so this formula gives us the magnitude of this vector A. So if a vector is expressed analytically in terms of its components, then the magnitude of that vector will be equal to its x component squared plus its y component squared plus its z component squared whole square root. Okay, so now let's talk about the magnitudes of unit vectors using this formula. So magnitudes of unit vectors. Okay, so we know that the unit vector I analytically can be written as 1i plus 0j plus 0k. And if we use this formula for the magnitude of this vector, so its magnitude will be equal to 1 squared plus 0 squared plus 0 squared whole square root, which gives us 1. So the magnitude of this unit vector is 1. Since it is a unit vector, its magnitude has to be 1. Similarly, j vector analytically is represented as 0i plus 1j plus 0k. So again, its magnitude will be equal to 0 squared plus 1 squared plus 0 squared, which is 1. Similarly, the unit vector k is written as 0i plus 0j plus 1k. So its magnitude is also equal to 1. Okay, so now we will talk about the position vector of a point. Position vector. So again, let us consider the rectangular coordinate system. Let us have a point with coordinates x, y, and z. So this is the point. Then this vector OP, the vector OP now will have the components along x, y, and z axis. Okay, now its coordinates x, y, and z basically will give us its components. Okay, so the component of vector OP along x axis will be this x only. Similarly, along y axis it has component y, and along z it has component z. So here OP vector, so we will call this vector as R, vector R. Here the vector OP represented by the vector R is called a radius vector or position vector of point P. With respect to origin. So it is given by, so R or OP vector, so will be equal to XI plus YJ plus ZK. So this is the radius vector R or position vector of this point P. So we have introduced the analytical representation of vectors. So now we will use this representation of vectors to define various algebraic terms that we did in the previous lecture using the geometrical representation. So fundamental definitions. analytical representation. Of vectors. So the first definition is equal vectors. So we define equal vectors previously geometrically, they're two vectors with the same directions and same magnitudes are equal. So analytically, two vectors, vector A expressed analytically as a1i plus a2j plus a3k, and a vector b which is b1i plus b2j plus b3k. So these two vectors are expressed analytically, then these two vectors are equal if their corresponding components are equal. There is, if the x component of A is equal to x component of B, y component and z component is equal to z component. There is a1 is equal to b1 and a2 is equal to b2 and a3 is equal to b3. So then these two vectors will be equal. So next is negative of a vector. So previously geometrically we defined that the negative of a vector is obtained by reversing the direction of that vector without changing its magnitude. So now negative of a vector, so suppose we have a vector expressed analytically, then negative of that vector will be obtained by multiplying all of its components with the negative sign. Okay, the negative of a vector A denoted by negative of A is a vector obtained by multiplying all the components of vector A by negative sign or minus sign. So if a vector A is a1i plus a2j plus a3k, then negative of that vector will equal to negative a1i plus negative a2j plus negative of a3k. So this is how we find the negative of a vector expressed analytically. And the third definition is unit vector. Okay, so the unit vector A hat in the direction of a vector A is given by unit vector is equal to the vector A divided by its magnitude. Okay, so if our vector A is again a1i plus a2j plus a3k, then the unit vector in the direction of this vector A will be equal to this vector divided by its magnitude, and magnitude will be a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square square root. Okay, this can be further written as a1 over a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square square root I plus a2 over a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square square root j, and plus a3 over a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square square root k. So this is how we find a unit vector in the direction of a vector. And the next definition is zero vector. So previously, geometrically, we defined that a zero vector is a vector with zero length or magnitude and with no specific direction. Okay, so zero vector analytically can be written as 0i plus 0j plus 0k. Okay, so it again represents the origin, which is just a point. Okay, so a null vector or a zero vector has no specified direction. So it has no component along x-axis, no component along y-axis, and no component along z-axis. So it has no specific direction, and it is represented by a single point, and it has zero length. Okay, so now we will talk about the algebraic operations of addition, subtraction, and scalar multiplication on vectors using their analytical representations. So we have seen all these algebraic operations previously in the first lecture using their geometrical representation. So addition of vectors. The sum of two vectors, vector A and B, vector B, is obtained by adding corresponding components of vector A and vector B. Okay, so in order to add two vectors, we add their corresponding components. Okay, so if our vector A is a1i plus a2j plus a3k, and our vector B is b1i plus b2j plus b3k, then the sum of the vectors A and B, A plus B, will be equal to the sum of the corresponding components. So A1 plus B1 I plus A2 plus B2 J plus A3 plus B3 K. So this will be the sum vector. Similarly, subtraction of vectors. So if again we consider these two vectors A and B, then A minus B will be obtained by subtracting the components of B from the corresponding components of A. So again, A minus B will be equal to the same as we did for addition, but now there will be minus sign over here. So A minus B will be equal to A1 minus B1i plus a to minus b to j plus a3 minus b3k. So this is the difference of the vectors a and b. Next, let's talk about the scalar multiplication. In the previous lecture, as you must have seen, we studied that if we multiply a vector by a scalar, then we get the scalar multiple of that vector. And that scalar multiple basically scales up or down the magnitude of that vector. So its magnitude is equal to the scalar times the magnitude of that vector. So scalar multiplication. So again, let A be a vector a1i plus a2j plus a3k and m be a scalar, then m times a is a vector. Which is scalar multiple of vector A. Scalar multiple of A. Is obtained by multiplying each component of the vector A with this scalar M. By multiplying each component of A by M. Okay, so M times A vector will be equal to M times A1i plus M times A2j plus M times A3k. And its magnitude, the magnitude of the scalar multiple will be equal to m times a1 squared, m times a2 squared, plus m times a3 squared whole square root. So this can be further written as m square into a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square whole square root, which is equal to m square root a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square root. So which is equal to m mod times the magnitude of A. Okay, so the magnitude of scalar multiple of A will be equal to the magnitude of scalar times the magnitude of the vector. Okay, so if we multiply a vector with a scalar and scalar let's say is 2 or minus 2, okay, then the magnitude of that vector will get double, it will get twice. Okay, so now we will solve some examples taken from the book that I recommended you in the first lecture. So we will pick some examples from the book and we will illustrate the topics that we have studied in today's lecture. So our first example is example 1. Determine the vector having initial point P with coordinates x1, y1 and z1 and terminal point Q with coordinates x2, y2 and z2, and find its magnitude. Okay, so we are given two points and we have to determine the vector from one point to another, and we also have to find its magnitude. So let us consider the rectangular coordinate system. Suppose this is our point P with coordinates x1, y1 and z1, and this is a point Q with coordinates x2, y2 and z2. Okay. So if we consider their position vectors from origin, so this is the position vector of point P and this is position vector of, these are also radius vector. So let us call this as R1 and this is R2. So we want to find the vector PQ from P to Q. Okay, so here R1 is the position vector or radius vector of this point P with coordinates x1, y1, z1. So R1 will be equal to x1i as we discussed previously in today's lecture. X1i plus y1j plus z1k. Similarly, R2 will be equal to x2i plus y2j plus z2k. Okay. So here we get a triangle of vectors. So again, using the triangle law of addition, we are doing the solution of this question using the triangle law of addition. Of vectors. So here you can see that OP plus PQ vector is equal to OQ vector. So here OP plus PQ is equal to OQ. Now what is OP vector? So OP is R1, PQ vector is unknown, and OQ vector is R2. So from here we can write PQ vector is equal to R2 minus R1. So PQ vector is equal to R2 vector is this. So x2i plus y2j plus z2k minus R1. R1 is x1i plus y1j plus z1k. Subtract them. So we will subtract the corresponding components of second vector from first vector, so we will get x2 minus x1i plus y2 minus y1j plus z2 minus z1k. So this is our vector, required vector PQ. Now what is its magnitude? So PQ magnitude. So as it is expressed analytically in its components, so magnitude will be equal to x component squared plus y component squared plus z component squared. So magnitude will be equal to x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared plus z2 minus z1 squared whole squared. Shown. Okay, so if we are given two points inside three-dimensional space, two points with given coordinates. So in order to find a vector from one point to another, we have to subtract the coordinates of first point from the second point to find the vector. So now let's have the second example. Okay, so this is our second example. Find a unit vector A in the direction of the vector from this to this. Okay, so here we first have to find the vector from P to Q, which is PQ vector, and then we have to find the unit vector in the direction of PQ vector. So we will use this formula. Unit vector A in the direction of PQ will be equal to PQ vector divided by magnitude of PQ vector. So first let us find PQ vector using the method that we discussed in the previous example, example 1. So here PQ vector will be equal to P to Q. So we will subtract the coordinates of P from Q. So PQ vector will be equal to 3 minus 1. So 3 minus 1i plus 2 minus 0 j plus 0 minus 1k. Okay. So this will be equal to 2i plus 2j minus k. So this is our PQ vector. And what is its magnitude? So magnitude of this vector is 2 squared plus 2 squared plus minus 1 squared square root, which is, what is this? 4 plus 4, 8 plus 1, 9 square root, which is equal to 3. So magnitude is 3. So what is then unit vector? So this is equal to the vector PQ divided by its magnitude. PQ vector is 2i plus 2j minus k divided by 3. So we will get 2 by 3i plus 2 by 3j minus 1 by 3k. So this is our required vector. Now let's have another example. Okay, so this is our example 3. So we are given two vectors A and B, and we have to find A plus B and A minus B. Okay, so here A plus B will be equal to, so A vector is 2i minus 3j plus 4k plus B vector is I plus 2j plus k. Now add them, so we add corresponding components. So 2 plus 1i, so we'll need minus 3 plus 2 j and 4 plus 1 k. So this will be equal to 3i minus j plus 5 k. Similarly, what is a minus b? So again 2i minus 3j plus 4 k minus I plus 2j plus k. Now we subtract component of b from the corresponding components of a, so we will get 2 minus 1i plus minus 3 minus 2j plus 4 minus 1k. So we will get 1i minus 5j plus 3k. So this is A minus B. So now let's have a look on the next example. Okay, so this is our example number 4. Determine the condition under which two non-zero vectors, vector A and vector B, are parallel. Okay, so we have to determine under which condition these two vectors will be parallel. Okay, so we will use the definition of parallel vectors. We know that two vectors are parallel if one of the vectors is a scalar multiple of the other vector. Okay, so here A and B vectors will be parallel if A is multiple of B or B is multiple of A. Suppose B is a multiple of A, there is B is equal to M times A, some scalar multiple of A. Okay, so from here we can write, so B is equal to M times A. So this implies, what is B? So B is B1i plus B2j plus B3k. This is equal to m times a vector. M times a is a1i plus a2j plus a3k. So b1i plus b2j plus b3k will be equal to m times a1i plus m times a2j plus m times a3k. So now these two vectors are equal. So by using the definition of equal vectors, their corresponding components must also be equal. So this implies b1 must be equal to m times a1, and b2 is equal to m times a2, and b3 is equal to m times a3. So we can also write it as b1 over a1 is equal to m, and b2 over a2 is equal to m, and b3 over a3 is equal to m. So here you can see that all these ratios are the same. So this implies b1 over a1 is equal to b2 over a2, which is equal to b3 over a3. So what is this condition? What this condition tells us is that the corresponding components are proportional. So this is the condition. So this implies, so this is our condition, which implies that corresponding components of parallel vectors are proportional. Proportional means they have a proportion between them. There is the ratio of corresponding components are always equal. Okay, so this is the condition that we had to find. So dear students, in today's lecture, we studied the analytical representation of a vector, and then we defined the algebraic terms and algebraic operations of addition and scalar multiplication using the analytical representation of vectors. And in the next lecture, we will prove the properties of addition and scalar multiplication of vectors using both their analytical representation and geometrical representation. So see you in the next lecture.